The chapter Lost Spring is written by Anise Chung, and the title means the lost phase of childhood of such unfortunate children who are denied the opportunities of learning and are thrown up to the demands of survival. The author succeeds in highlighting the fact, the callousness of the society, of the politicians and the government class, who do not do anything for the development of these poor people. The first story in the chapter is titled, Sometimes I Find a Rupee in the Garbage. The chapter here starts with a conversation between the author and a young boy named Sahib, who has migrated from the green fields of Dhaka in Bangladesh during the 1971 war. He is scrounging for gold in the garbage dumps of the neighborhood when the author encounters him. Scrounging means looking for, and gold means anything which could be of use to him. Now she asks him what and why is he doing, and he replies by saying that I got nothing else to do. Thoughtlessly she says that you could definitely go to a school, but immediately she realizes how hollow the advice must have sounded, because for lives of these children, there are no schools in their neighborhood and no one ever tries to build one. Further, the author says that if I build a school, will you be interested in coming? Then Sahib replies in affirmation. And after a few days, she finds him running towards her, asking whether the school is ready, and feeling embarrassed, she replies that it takes longer to make a school. But promises like hers abound in every corner of his bleak world, because all the politicians and the government classes, all the promises that they make, they are always unfulfilled, and no one ever does anything for the development of these people. Sahib's full name is Sahib-e-Alam, and it means Lord of the Universe. If Sahib ever gets to know the meaning of his name, he will really have a hard time believing it, because his name is directly oppositional to the situation of his life. He is just a part of the army of barefoot boys who appear like the morning birds and disappear at noon. The literary device of simile has been used in the line, who appear like the morning birds and disappear at noon. So over the period of time, the author has been able to recognize each one of them. Now one day she approaches them and asks why they are not wearing slippers or chappals, as they say. There are different explanations which are being given. One of them says that his mother simply did not bring them down from the shelf. And the other one says that even if she did, he will throw them off. So it is being realized that it is not the lack of money, but it is a tradition to stay barefoot, is one explanation. And this behavior of theirs of not wearing chappals, it highlights their perpetual state of poverty, which can also be mean a constant state of poverty or a never-ending state of poverty. The fact that they stay barefoot is a highlight to this, that they are in a situation where they will never be able to get out of their poverty. So the author further tells the story of a man from Udipi who lived near a temple, and he prayed for chappals every day. And now when she visited that place, she sees that now the situation is quite different. Earlier, the child prayed for something which he could never have. And now there is a boy who comes from school who throws away the bag and the shoes he is wearing. So there is a difference between situations of everyone's life. Her acquaintance with these barefoot boys lead her to Simapuri, which is a place in the periphery of Delhi, but it is far, far away from it metaphorically. This is the place where all the squatters from Bangladesh migrated during the 1971 war, and they live in destitute condition. There are houses, but they are temporary houses. They are made of tin, trampoline, no sewage arrangements, no drainage systems. There is only 10,000 rag pickers. So they are living here over 30 years. They do not have an identity. They do not have permits. All they have is just ration cards so that they can get and they can buy grain for their survival. Food is more important for them rather than an identity. This is what is the explanation given by them. And if at the end of the day, we can feed our families and go to bed without an aching stomach, we would rather live here than in the fields that gave us no grain. This is the explanation given by women who sit in tattered saris, who are not able to manage to get a good piece of cloth for them. All they can manage is to teach everyone the art of rag picking, and over the period of time, this has acquired a skill and the promotion of a fine art. They live in transit home, which means temporary, and garbage to them is gold. This is a very important line from the chapter, and the poetic device used is hyperbole, which means a mere exaggeration of fact. How can a garbage be gold to anyone? But here it is gold to them because the different meanings attached to the garbage, which we will further see. So garbage is their daily bread. That means it is because of their art of rag picking they are able to get food for them. It is providing with them a shelter, even though if it is a leaking roof, even though they are not able to manage a permanent house or a permanent roof over their head, but still they associate garbage with gold because it is only because of the rag picking that they are able to get all the things which they need for survival. I sometimes find a rupee, even a 10 rupee note, says Sahib. So while scrounging for gold in the garbage dumps, sometimes he found rupees. And when he finds a silver coin in the heap of garbage, he would definitely not stop looking for more. So that is the reason they keep looking for this gold, anything which could be of use to them. They do not stop looking for it. And the different meanings attached to the word garbage here is that for the children it is wrapped in wonder, because children, when they look for all the things which could be of use to them in the garbage, sometimes they find rupees, sometimes they might find a toy which would be used by them to play. So for children it is wrapped in wonder, it is something which is, you know, which they feel excited about. But for the elders, it has a really different meaning. For elders, it is a mean of survival. It is their daily bread. It is the roof over their house, even if it is a leaking roof. So one winter morning, the author sees Sahib that he is standing by a fenced gate of a neighborhood club, and it is a tennis ground, and he is watching two young men playing tennis over there. He likes the game, he admits, and he feels that maybe in life he ever gets a chance to play that game. And after these men, they have done with their playing, Sahib gets a chance to go into the ground and play the game. So the author feels that, okay, this is something which he can achieve sometime in his life. He is also wearing tennis shoes, she notices, but one of them has a hole in them. So she thinks that probably some rich boy might have discarded them because of the hole. But for boys like Sahib, wearing a shoe is also like a dream come true. This is the difference in the lives of children and of people, which she highlights here. Another morning when she again sees Sahib, she feels rather surprised to see him today, because today he is not having that big plastic bag of his on his shoulder, carrying garbage over the streets. But now she sees that now Sahib is making his way to the milk booth. He is holding a steel canister and he says that now I work in a tea stall which is over the road and I get 800 rupees and all my meals. So does he like the job? The author asks, and his face fell. He is not happy anymore. The steel canister weighs heavier on him than the plastic bag which he used to carry around so lightly. This is because Sahib has lost the sense of freedom which he earlier had. He is no longer his own master. And that is the difference, which earlier he was very happy. He used to roam around. He used to go here and there with his friends. But now he is duty bound. Although he is getting 800 rupees and all the meals, but still he is not happy because he is no longer his own master. So with this, the first story comes to an end. And with this, my video also comes to an end. In the next video, I'll take up the next story, which is I want to drive a car, and it is a story about a young boy named Mukesh. So stay tuned and watch out for the next video. Thank you.